Okay, so let's just set it up. Hello, Dhananjay sir. It's good to see you. Hi, Dad. So yeah, we'll just wait for everyone to join in, and we'll begin. Just give it a minute. Just sending the invite to a few people. Are you able to hear me? Thank you, sir. I hope you are able to hear me and all clearly. This is slightly better. Perfect. So we'll just wait for a few more people to join in, and the Cobalt Blue team also to come, Ruchi and Sandeep, and then we shall begin. So just wait for some time. In the meanwhile, I hope you guys are having a good Sunday. It's getting really hot, and you'll probably see me dabbing my forehead quite some time. So yeah, we're discussing a very hot topic, so I guess it's poetic enough that we should feel hot. Hi, Ro. Oh. Hi, Mom. Yeah, I might as well take this opportunity to say Happy Mother's Day. I mean, I wished you online, but I didn't say it. So, yeah. Thank you. Yeah, it is. So I guess while we wait for a few people, I can at least give you a little bit of the background of what this is about and all. And I mean, we can always like reiterate some of the things. So this idea of mathematical, it's kind of started with a discussion that has been going on for almost 18 months with the Cobalt Blue team, and I guess like a few weeks back, we after we did a session, there was this idea that why don't we discuss more of these topics and all. So the reason I'm very interested in doing this session or even this new series called Mathematical, it comes from the term myth and themes, right? So that's where it comes from. And obviously, it's a wordplay on the term mathematical. That's only because, I mean, while, we all enjoy mythology and the stories, and obviously the best thing about the stories is just, listening to it, seeing the performance and all. I do feel that the difference between a story in mythology and the story you would see in a normal film or comics and anything else, there's a little difference. It's the way we engage with mythology is almost as if we are engaging with the culture. And it's very important to always look back and to peel the different layers of what the mythology is offering us. Because sometimes they can bring out a new perspective altogether. And I think I'm very interested in that. And I think one of the reasons I was very keen in trying to create content around these sessions was, Indian mythology is great, and we obviously will discuss a lot of Indian mythology and all, but sometimes the best way of appreciating mythology comes when when you're looking at different types of mythologies, Egyptian, Greek, Norse, but also as you're going to discuss today, Polynesian mythology and all. And I think when you look outside, you kind of start appreciating what you have. At the same time, you also are able to have a change of pace and just have fun with it. So yeah, that was the reason to start off mathematics. And by the way, this is just one format. We're starting with the live stream format where we're discussing a few stories and the themes. But soon enough, there'll be more stuff. There's going to be, for those of you who are interested, there's also going to be content around mythology as a subject itself, not just about stories, but what is it? How do you engage in mythology itself? What does it take to create mythology? How is mythology itself evolved? So it's slightly going to be more, intellectual, but at the same time, it's going to deep dive into some of the stories and all. And I'm still trying to figure out what kind of format that should be in. But yeah, that should be another thing. And along with that, we'll have a lot more content that is snackable and more consumable on, shorter formats and all. So yeah, stay tuned for that. And I hope you guys are enjoying this. So yeah, I think we have a few people joining in. Hello, Reno Andy. It's great. So we have a few more people. Yeah, so anyway, while we wait, I had a few questions. While I obviously have ideas for topics and I'm going to be discussing more things, if there are any particular myths or stories that you find interesting and you would like to hear a retelling of it, or you have a particular question about mythologies, feel free to comment. I mean, I will definitely answer here, or at least, whenever we connect again. So, and please, provide your suggestions if you have any particular ideas or you would want to see a particular topic being covered. I think, I have had the privilege of discussing a lot of details with, obviously, my family, sure. But I think Dhananjay sir, Dhananjay sir, he used to be my school teacher in Dhirubhai Ambani. And he's someone I've always had very interesting interactions, right from school, where he used to talk about history, to when recently I got in touch with him again and we were discussing our love for mythology. He puts a lot of interesting content on LinkedIn and all. And I think we've had some very, very intense and interesting discussions. So it's just it's a privilege for having him on this session, and would love to see his feedback. But please, the rest of you also, do check out his profile and his content along. I think that's very interesting about mythology. Mythology doesn't belong to anyone. It doesn't belong to one person. You can add to it. You can obviously add your own interpretation and the retelling. But the best thing about mythology is the discussions and the ideas that you come that comes out with churning of it. In fact, Mythematical came with this idea that instead of telling one story and just discussing it, I'm always going to have multiple stories and I'm going to churn out the themes that come out of it. And obviously, these are obviously my interpretation and my thinking and based on my limited understanding and experience. But the idea is that, you know, mythologies always have a personal connection with all of us, whether or not we like to admit it. So it's always a good thing to, like, you know, try to seek out mythology from different sources, different content, and feel free to even create your own mythology. Mythology is not something that is static, that has already been happened and all. So it's always interesting to challenge the mythologies, to interpret them again. And oh wow, Ruchi has joined in. Hi Ruchi. So yeah, I just gave an introduction of Cobalt Blue and you know, Mythematical, and it's good to see you. Dhananjay sir, you've written the intent with my... Definitely, I didn't mean to question the intent. I mean, in fact, I have a very interesting topic that I'll be covering in later things, something called the mythology motive matrix. You know, the concept of, like, you know, how do you understand the motive behind someone discussing, engaging or critiquing a mythology. And obviously, there's a lot of political and cultural component to it. But how do you acknowledge it and then work around it? And I think that's an interesting topic that I have in mind for covering. And it's a very important thing. But what I meant was that we shouldn't be scared to experiment with mythology, creating it in terms of engaging with it. Because ultimately, like always, mythology has evolved over time. So it's important to also play around with it rather than see it as some sort of an esoteric content that was only meant to be dealt with scholars and academicians. And I think that's the fun of it, right? So yeah, we have a few more people joined in, and I think we can start now. So as I told you, I think I just gave a introduction, and today's topic is on theft of fire. And obviously, I think when we hear the word theft of fire, we have the famous story of Prometheus. You know, we know, many of us even know about the story. We've heard about it in, like, bits and pieces, or we've heard a variation of it. And yeah, definitely. I think the stories do carry our culture, and it's very interesting how they carry it. So yeah, so as I was saying, the theft of fire is something that is always been associated with a couple of stories we've heard. It's been sensationalized, dramatized a lot by the Greek plays and the Western culture and art. But what's interesting is that it's not only limited to the story of Prometheus. There are different cultures that have dealt with it. And what's more is, there were almost more than 15 to 20 cultures that I came across that had a story around it. Now, the stories, some of the stories just had a variation in terms of what exactly happened. It was almost like a replacement of the same plot point with just one character. But at the same time, there were some stories that were diametrically different in terms of the plot point and the theme, except for the concept of stealing fire. And that's the reason I settled on, like, three stories. And what I also did was that this time I have, while I have not chosen an Indian story, there is a story in India that has a similar theme. It comes from a Vedic, it comes from the Vedas. The reason I didn't choose that, I'll talk about it, is because it's not as much a story as much as a, you know, mere mention. And what's interesting is that it's almost like it's referring to a story that has been lost. And that's something, a very common theme in our Vedas, where, like, you know, some characters or some person is just mentioned, and it's through that mentioning of the story we kind of understand the story. Which is also, you know, one of the reasons why when Puranas came and the Puranic age, the stories became more coherent. They became more easier to consume, and a lot of people at different classes were able to reach out to it. Vedas were something that was still a very niche, a very niche crowd had access to it. But Puranas started becoming, Puranas, they started becoming accessible to everyone. So yeah, that was the thing, and I'll come to that story of Indian mythology, which deals with theme, the theft of fire. But before we go on to the different stories, and I'll be obviously talking about the Prometheus story and all, I see a couple of more people join in. Hello, everyone. So we are just about to begin session. I was just giving an introduction. I see. Hi, Likla. Hi, Nikita Baby. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Cool. So one thing I want to bring out is this idea of the theme, right? We're going to be discussing fire, okay? And fire is one of the classical elements in, like, philosophy and in many religions also, okay? So I'm going to show you this. Are you able to see this? Is it? I hope it's not mirror image. I keep making that mistake every time. Just let me know if you can see this. It's clear to you. Yeah, so I mean, it should be visible, right? Yeah. So what I'm going to talk about is this thing of the four elements, right? And we've talked about water, you know, in one of our previous sessions where we talked about the floods and we talked about the importance of water. And today we're going to be talking about fire. Earth and air is something we'll cover soon enough. If you can see where all this, the session themes are going, you can already see that. But what I want to talk about is this concept of the four elements. We've all heard about this, right? I mean, it became very famous with this idea of the Dan Brown comic of Angels and Demons, the four elements, the Illuminatis. But I mean, this concept of the four elements go way beyond. I mean, they go way back to, you know, our mythologies and our religious things. What's interesting is every culture has some variation of the elements. I mean, the Hindu culture itself has this, has the concept of Panch Mahabhut, which is five elements. So these are the four: the fire, earth, water, and air is already there. And there's also this thing called Akash, which is space. But in the Greek, in the Greek traditions, in their philosophies, it was actually the four elements that had been agreed upon, and then the fifth one called ether, which is sort of a space thing. So there was some similarities. But what's interesting is that these elements, they came way before Socrates and all. I mean, generally we think of associating them with Aristotle, but Aristotle was like in, you know, almost the third or second the fourth century BC, and there were philosophers, the pre-Socratic philosophers, who had come up with this idea. In fact, the person named Empedocles, one of the earliest philosopher, was the first one to propose this idea of the four elements. And what's interesting is in the Greek philosophy, there was this obsession of trying to understand which one is the primary one. So the archne, the word arch, right? The archaic and all these things. This word means the oldest. And the philosophers were very obsessed with trying to find out which one was the oldest one. So every philosopher, there were always a philosopher that came in who had like an obsession with one of the elements, and they tried to prove that that was the oldest one that, you know, kind of gave birth to the rest of them. So Thales gave, had this argument that water is the primary, the primary things. That's why a lot of the stories and all obviously begin with this idea of the everything came from a watery depths, a watery chaos, right? So he kind of had this thing that, you know, culture and everything came from water. And that's the reason water was given like a new importance. But his own disciple, Anaximander, so it's almost like, you know, he was his student and his own disciple. He didn't agree with that. He said that none of the elements could have come first. They must have all come together. But his disciple, the Anaximenes, so Anaximenes believed that air was the first thing that came in. And it wasn't until a person called Heraclitus who kind of talked about fire being the most primordial element and all. And the idea that fire was something that gave birth to the world. Now, obviously, if you look at our modern science, these four elements are not exactly the basis of the creation. I mean, By science, fire is just it's a sort of a it's a combustion. It's a sort of an energy. Water is a compound. Air and earth are composites. So it's a little unfair to even compare them. But I mean, if we are being poetic about it, we can consider fire being the birth of everything, Big Bang, right? So that's how it came in. And so what's interesting is that Aristotle was the first one to coin these guys as not just philosophers, but physicists. In fact, he kind of differentiated them because these people had rejected the claim that mythology explanations make sense to explain the world. They wanted to use these four elements as a basis to explain a more proto-scientific way of going about it. And it's interesting that, you know, this clash of the elements was what kind of had this distinction between the idea of mythological explanation versus an observational scientific explanation that began to churn out in the Western thought. Obviously, I mean, the Hindu mythology and the Hindu rishis, they had a very different way of approaching them. I don't think there was the clash between which elements was more. In fact, they kind of believed all elements had their own powers and all. But then again, I mean, in Indian mythology and in our rituals, fire was a very important thing. Fire, the idea of a contained fire, you know, was very sacred because yagna, which comes from the Vedic concept to the Puranic concept and then into Hinduism itself, is something that came in because fire was considered the mouth of a god, right? Agni was something that you could do, and it was something that you can exchange, you know. So when you give them sort of an offering, you can ask for something. So fire became a very important conduit. So yeah, with that in mind, I thought, like, you know, I just wanted to give you a little bit of a context of fire itself. Yeah, and I think we should move on to our first story, because what's interesting is that while these elements of, you know, something that we all sorted out, fire has this common property in our stories, which was always associated with something that had to be taken, that always had to be, that was not simply just given in a very clear way. It was something that had to be fought for. And it involved sometimes an action that was not seen in a moral light, but it had to be done. And the three stories we are going to discuss is going to be about what created that situation and what are the consequences of it. So yeah, should we go into the first story? The first story is going to be on, as you guessed it, Prometheus. I'm sure many of you have heard it. So I will talk about it in a way that will at least give you a context of the fire itself and what exactly happened. Just a slight bit of a context. The story of Prometheus comes from the 8th and the 7th century BC. It comes from this write-up called Theogony, which was written by Hesiod, one of the earlier poets. Theogony was actually a poem written. So Hesiod and Homer were one of the most famous poets and mythologists that had come in. And you have to see, like, you know, they came in 7th and 8th century. That's almost 4 centuries before the philosophers had come in. So he was already an ancient person. The stories were already something that was ancient by almost 500, 600 years to many of the philosophers. So it's very important to understand history, that history also has evolved. There's not like a static history, right? And the story comes there. And obviously, the stories also evolve. In this story, there are certain things that do not have elements that come in the later tellings and all. And it also kind of tells you some of the authorial intent that was there. So, yeah, so let's begin the story. Just before I begin the story, I thought I'll give you a bit of a context. So Prometheus, right? And I'm just doing this because it's just easier to remember the names and all. I kind of figured that it's a good way of remembering them. So we're going to talk about Prometheus. As I said, it comes from Theogony and has a display. And what you need to understand is the Greek world, right, has different generations, you know, like our Indian mythologies also, they have different generations, and each generation had its own time and, significance in the mythology. So the first ones who came in were called the primordials, and the leader was, Uranus, okay, or Uranos. Actually, in the Greek word, it's Uranos. Uranus is actually a Romanized word, but I just thought it's easier to remember, so that's why I called him Uranus. He and Gaia were the one who produced the Titans, Cronus being one of the oldest one. And Cronus and Rhea produce the Olympians. Now, what's interesting is that there was a prophecy by, Uranus knew that his son is going to finally defeat him. And that's exactly what happened, where, Uranus not only, killed his father, castrated him through his genitals in the sea, kind of a thing. And more about that later. Zeus did the same thing. I mean, Cronus had the same, same fear, because there was a prophecy that his son is going to do that, and he used to keep eating his sons. And finally, when Zeus got saved, because Rhea fed him a piece of stone instead of Zeus, when he comes back, he kind of fights the Titans. And this fight between the Olympians, who lived in Olympus, and the Titans, the older generation, was called the Titanomachy, the great battle that happened between the two giants. And this is where our story starts, because before the creation of humanity, the Greek gods Olympus, they had won a great battle against these older generations called the Titans. Now, most of the Titans were destroyed and they were thrown in this eternal hell called the Tartarus. Tartarus is actually like the Greek version of hell. It's like the spit that was there, and most of them were there. But the one Titan named Prometheus, his name actually has been interpreted as meaning foresight, someone who knew what could happen, who could think beyond, right? And his brother Epimetheus, Epimetheus stands for afterthinking, afterthought, someone who does not think, does an action and all. So Prometheus had convinced his brother Epimetheus to leave the Titans, even though he belonged to them, and join Zeus and help Zeus win the fight. Because he kind of had foreseen that, it's going to be Zeus who's going to be finally winning this thing and ruling the world. Now, as a thanks, Zeus had entrusted both the brothers with the task of creating all living things. Zeus had finally decided that, we need to do something more. The world is too big a place to just have gods in it. So he kind of gave these two the craft of it, because both of them were very artistic. They had many ideas and all. And he had kind of given the gift of the gods. All the gods had given a bit of a gift. Athena gave wisdom, reasoning. Hephaestus gave the craft. So all the gods had different things that they gave. And they gave it to Epimetheus. Now Epimetheus went on and he gave some of the gift to the birds. He gave them flights. He gave some of the other beings the ability to move through water. He gave some animals the ability to move through grass. He gave the beasts some glistening scales, and some he gave fur and claws. And because he was someone who didn't think it through, he kind of distributed all these very important gifts amongst the animal. And he left one of the creations that Prometheus was working on, humankind. He left them with nothing. They were almost naked and unprotected, and they had nothing to survive the world. All they had was the skin and their own hands. But Prometheus decided to create them in the image of the gods, the image of the Olympians, and he created them. And he made sure that while they did not have all the physical attributes, Prometheus taught these men the different art forms, pottery making, a different kind of elements and all, whether it was fishing, agricultural, everything, and also taught him the secret of fire, because he had ultimately believed that these, he really cared about these creatures, and he wanted the creatures to ultimately thrive in this world. Now, Zeus was not very happy with this. In fact, Zeus did not want to give such a precious resource like fire to them. But Prometheus, being a very close friend, he was able to convince him, and Zeus agreed only on one condition, that the mortals, they do not come to Mount Olympus. They do not get to stay in Mount Olympus. They make their own self-made settlements around the Mount Olympus, and they can worship the gods if they want to thrive in the world, in exchange for obviously divine help and other things. This was something because Zeus considered humans to be very subservient creatures, and he believed that they are just vulnerable to the classic elements. Water, fire, earth and all is something that they will never be able to control, and somewhere down the line that was insecurity, and he wanted them to be dependent on the gods. But Prometheus had a bigger plan for his crude creations. He wanted a greater purpose for them, and he had a trick in mind to ensure that they get what they, they can get more benefits. So in fact, one day in the city of Mekone, which is a city in Greece that plays a very significant part in mythology and even currently in history and all. Zeus had decided that sacrifices need to be made. The concept of sacrifice, you know, had to be created. And he had given Prometheus the task to do. And Prometheus came up with this plan that involved killing a bull and cutting it in two parts. So what he did was, he cut the bull and in one bowl, he put the bones and he covered it with like a glistening layer of fat. While in the other one, he put the nice juicy meat, but he on top of it, he put this disgusting skin and stomach layering on top. And he, you know, he brought it on to Zeus. Now, Zeus, obviously, looking at the glistening layer of fat, he was more excited about that and he chose that. Only to discover that he'd been deceived. And because of this deceivement, because the god had finally chosen the fat and the bone, the fate of this sacrifice ritual had been sealed. Gods were always, for rest of the eternity, going to be offered bones while the mortals could consume the meat and ultimately, live prosperously. And this is something the gods did not like, but this is something that had become, and Prometheus was to be blamed. He was very angry at Prometheus, but he took out this anger. Zeus finally took out this anger on the mortals. He kind of, took away fire from them, and so that they couldn't cook or use it for any other purpose. And the world just suddenly went into chaos. There was complete darkness. The gods weren't listening to them, and humans were scared and worried, and they were just they did not know what to do, and Prometheus did not want his creation to be denied the resources, this resource. So what he did was, despite a clear order from Zeus that fire is never going to be given to the mortals again, he climbed up the Mount Olympus to the workshop of Hephaestus, the Olympian blacksmith god, and Athena, where the fire was kept in the forge. He took this plant called the fennel stalk. You know, there's a special type of plant that was there, and within that he hid the fire and he brought it down safely to the people. And with that he gave it back, and he also taught them how to harness it. Unlike before, this fire was something precious, so he had to teach them how to use that. And Prometheus's flame became a catalyst for a rapid progression of civilization, because with fire came technology, with fire came elements that you could control. With fire also came a point where humans no longer were scared of the natural world, but were able to seek and control it. Suddenly they weren't as fearful of the gods as Zeus would have liked them to be. They could comfort themselves with food, they could comfort themselves with warmth, and they could live prosperously, and humans finally were thriving. Now Zeus was furious. He could not believe the betrayal. I mean, that was one of his best friends, someone he completely trusted with this, who went against a direct order. And Zeus, the great patriarch, was not someone who used to take defiance in a very, very light light. So he ordered Prometheus to be chained to a cliff, and each day a vulture would come and peck on his liver and eat his liver. Now Prometheus was a god, right? He was a titan after all. So each day his liver would regrow, only to be pecked and eaten again by the vulture the next day. And this just went on almost for eternity. But what's interesting is that Prometheus, despite being in perpetual agony, never really complained about this. He told Zeus, in fact, in the stories, there is a conversation with Zeus where he says that, Zeus, you're wrong. You do not know the potential that human beings have, and I can live with my consequence. In fact, he even kind of prophesies that, you know, one of Zeus's mortal or semi-mortal sons is going to be his downfall. That became a different story altogether. But he kind of had this thing, and he was able to see that, you know, what he did was for the benefit of mankind. And that's the reason Prometheus grew up to be not just a god and a trickster, but also a cultural hero. The worship of Prometheus is not very well known historically, but there have been evidence that there could have been some people who followed his sect, Promethean task, Prometheusness. It became a thing. Even historically, the word Prometheus became something of defying a natural order to bring about a betterment in society. That was how it was used. And with this thing, humans were able to have fire despite the gods never wanting them to be. And obviously this caused Zeus to, you know, ultimately come up with new plans. The concept of him introducing Pandora, the first woman, as a way to create problems in humankind came because of this thing. It was a direct consequence of that. We've spoken about that in our previous story. But the main thing is, in this story, this is how Prometheus stole fire and gave it to man. Hope you guys like the story. And let me know if you have any questions. I see a few comments. Insecurity comes from inability to control nature and still persist. Exactly. I think, sir, that's a very good way of putting it. I think the fire, this thing, the fire itself, there is a lot of association with insecurity. In fact, one of the things I was thinking about, and I had put it as like one of the statements when I was just talking about the session, was that I think the fire itself, as the flickering flame of fire, they remind us of the slippery nature of power. And I think that's the thing with fire. The fire, it changes the power dynamics between those who have it and those who didn't. So yeah, that was the story. And I must say, Prometheus story is something that has been reenacted and enacted. By the way, for those of you who really, feel bad for Prometheus, just want to tell you that after a lot of ages, there was someone who came and helped him, was able to convince Zeus to let him get away from the punishment because he had suffered enough. That person was Heracles or Hercules, who after or during his task came and set Prometheus free. So in all fairness, Prometheus did get out, but after a lot of torture. So that was the story of Prometheus. Next, we shall go into the next story. Hope you guys are ready for that. By the way, if you have any questions, keep posting it. I think the question of, there are many things that have, this is just my retelling after reading many, many stories. Please understand there are many versions of the same stories. There are also reenactments and creative liberties that even the authors took. The way the Prometheus himself is depicted, whether as a hero or whether as just a, as a comic character or as someone who was defying an order, depends on which story you're reading through and what was the intent of it. As we were talking about, the motive of mythology itself. Cool. So the next story is the story of Maui's trick. Now this story, Maui, I'm pretty sure anyone who's seen Moana or has at least, in our recent memory, has realized that we think of Maui, we think of Dwayne Johnson's The Rock, because that's how Disney had made it famous. And many things they did get right about Maui, but they've changed Maui a lot. In terms of the depiction, in terms of it. But I would say they had done a fairly good job creatively. And in case you haven't seen it, I'll give you a little bit of context of what Maui is. First of all, this comes from the Polynesian mythology, right? Now, what is Polynesia? Polynesia is these thousand islands that are spread across in the Pacific Oceans. In fact, one of the largest country is is New Zealand. I'll show you what I mean. Okay, so Maui, right? That's how it's spelled, Maui. Okay, the accent on A is R. That's the word that we sometimes use. So that's the reason. We have a habit of butchering the words many times. The terms itself, Hindi names itself become, Rama, Lakshmana, and all. But sometimes it's better to try to remember how they were pronounced, in the colloquial language. So Maui was written this way, and that's how it was pronounced. And so you see Australia right here, right? And New Zealand is here. So between when you see New Zealand, you see Hawaii, which is right up here, the Easter Islands and Samoa. This is the Polynesian Triangle. This is the region of Polynesia. And there are thousands of islands out here. Some are states, some are properties of another country and all. But there are many, many things. So what's interesting is, like Hindu mythology, which varies across the region, but yet has some common basis, common themes, common characters and all, the same thing is true for the mythologies. While there are stories which have common stories, common characters, Maui is one of the characters that whose adventures and exploits are told throughout the region. And obviously, they vary in like different region. The stories change and they take their own form, which kind of tells you more about the culture itself. Just remember, whenever you see a commonality between mythology, you're kind of witnessing the humanity, the thing. But when you see the difference between mythology, you're kind of seeing the identity of the culture. And I think that's the reason I'm very interested in comparative mythology, because it's easy to find out what the difference is, but sometimes finding out what exactly connects us reveals a lot more about ourselves. So Maui itself, it's very important to know that Maui, he's not considered as much a deity or a god as much he's considered a cultural hero. He's a trickster. In many cultures, we have this concept of a trickster. Prometheus was also considered a trickster because of this. In a Hindu mythology, the trickster is someone like Narad. He has the traits of a trickster. But then again, I mean, we cannot force fit these archetypes that Western philosophers and writers had come with. But yeah, I mean, that's the thing. And Maui himself is like a folk hero. And he's someone who celebrated because many of his stories and all are all about how the world came to be, you know, and how the world, it is thing. So etiology, you know, etiology is this origin of the world. And mythology does this fantastic job of trying to talk about the origin of anything, right? So many of Polynesian's etiological concepts, you know, the concept of, you know, islands came because Maui used his hook to, you know, fish out of, you know, to take out a fish, but out came the land. The idea that, you know, sun used to move too fast and Maui slowed them down. So this is a story of how Maui came to steal the fire after, and kind of, you know, like he kind of tried to get the fire after he lost it again and again. Yeah, that's true. We cannot fit it. But I think what's interesting is the themes by themselves do come out when you do engage with it. It's important to know at different levels, they do have similarities, and at different levels, they are very different. But at the same time, you know, that's something that can always be discussed and, like, you know, that can be mined out. So, yeah, as I said, the story of Maui Strick. So one evening after having a very hearty meal, Maui used to love food. Maui was lying down and noticing the fire that was in the hearth in his village. And he kept seeing the flickering flames, and he thought to himself, I wonder where this fire comes from. Now, Maui was a very curious person. In fact, most of his exploits have always begun with him being curious about something. And he is the kind of person who probably got himself out of trouble as much as he got himself in trouble. So he decides that he's going to find out how this fire came. So in the middle of the night, when everyone is sleeping, he goes to village and he extinguishes all the fire so that there's no fire in the world. Because he wants to figure out where does the fire come from. And he goes back to his tent and he waits. Now, the next day, he wakes up with a scream and the villagers are screaming. He's like, you know, oh my God, there's no fire. How are we going to cook? How are we going to, you know, how are we going to heat the world? You know, world's going cold. And everyone's frightened. And then finally, Taranga. Okay. So, yeah, I just want to show you the names. Okay. So, Maui, right? Maui's mother's name is Taranga. Okay. And Taranga is basically the Rangtira. Okay, Rangtira is the elder of the village. That's the word in the Polynesian word for the respected elders. Think of the panchayat leader kind of a thing. So Taranga is his mother and she's the leader. And she comes to say that, you know, okay, someone has to go and get the fire from the great goddess Mahuika. Okay, so Mahuika. Okay, now Mahuika also happens to be Maui's grandmother, basically the mother of Taranga, who's the mother of Maui. Okay, so this is a little bit of a family story too. Okay, and she's the goddess of fire. So she tells that someone has to do this. Someone has to go to the goddess and ask for fire. And no one's eager to see Mauika because she's lives in this scorching volcanic mountain and she's very frightening to look at. But Maui just suddenly offers. He's like, I'll go. Seeing his plan is working out. And he decides to do. Everyone's cheering from him. He's suddenly becoming the leader. And Maui loves the praises. Okay. The Taranga tells him one thing. He's like, okay, be careful, my son. Although you are a descendant of Mauika, she does not take kindly if you try to trick her. Okay. Do not trick her. She's very benevolent, but she's not someone who likes being tricked. Okay. You can already see the foreshadowing what Maui is going to do. Okay. something that, you know, always happens in all mythologies, right? Now, Maui decides to, you know, Maui says that, yeah, don't worry, I will go to the, you know, my great ancestor, Maui-ka, and I'll bring back fire, and he assures everyone, and he sets out, and he goes through blistering winds and scorching deserts, and he goes to the end of the world, and he finally comes across this big mountain, and there's a cave, and he puts on a special enchantment out there to protect himself so that he doesn't get burned from the heat altogether. Maui is, after all, a deity himself. But nothing could prepare him for what he saw. Because as soon as he entered, within the lava suddenly came a form. And this form was sort of a feminine form with, like, you know, flowing hair, a flowing lava gown. And very frightening at first, Maui kept his still. And Maui-ka just notices this small being out there and kind of reaches out and puts him in his hand while he's standing there. And she's like, who is this demi-mortal that has entered my dwelling? Maui is like, gathers his courage and he says, I'm Maui, son of Taranga. Huh? You are son of Taranga? Maui? Like, yes, I'm the last born. I am Maui Tiki Tiki Ataranga. That was his full name. Very kind of a, I like his name a lot in this. Suddenly she's like, okay, welcome Maui Atiki Tiki Taranga. Welcome to my flames. Welcome grandchild. So she's suddenly very happy to see him. Now, she's, you know, she kind of tries to sniff his scent and, you know, she tries to understand, like, you know, what is like, what does he come for? So she asks him, like, why have you come, O Maui? Maui says that all the fire in the world has been extinct, and I have come to ask you for fire. For a brief second, he thought she's going to get angry, but Maui-ka listens closely and she laughs. And then suddenly she takes out her hand. Each of her fingernails were big flames that were there. And she takes out one fingernail, breaks it off, which is like a flame, and she gives it to Maui. She's like, take this to your people. Honor this fire as you've honored me. So Maui now takes this fire and he leaves this volcanic house of Maui-ka. But while he's out of the way, he's like, I still don't know where the fire comes from. How does she make fire? So what she, you know, what he decides to do is like, okay, maybe I have to see if she can, I can, like, you know, get rid of all the fire. She may show how to make fire. So he goes to the next, you know, a stream, and he throws the fire directly inside. He comes back to Maui-ka. And he says, he makes up an excuse, like, I'm so sorry, I kind of tripped and it just fell down. And could I just have another piece of fire? Maui-ka just thinks about it. And then she, you know, she's like, okay, genuine mistake, takes out another piece of her nail and gives it to him. Maui goes back. This time, he just throws it up in the air. Comes back. He's like, oh, I'm so sorry. I kind of, this time a snake came and he just took it away from me. And he does this again and again. Every time he comes back, a new excuse. Now, initially, Maui-ka is not really, not suspecting anything. But soon enough, when she's on her 19th nail, after she's given all the fingernails and her toenails, she's on her 19th nail, she says something is up. When Maui comes back for the 20th time, she gets really, really mad. She knows that there's something's been off about this. She realizes that, you know, Maui has been tricking her, and she gets really, really mad. And she, you know, she screams at Maui, like, Maui, you have done me a great dishonor by trying to trick me, and you shall be punished for this. No longer the world will get the fire that they deserve. They can almost die in hell if I want. And saying this, she completely erupts and there's like fire everywhere. Now Maui is surrounded by fire. He's not sure what to do. He wants to escape the thing. So Maui has the ability to change into any form he wants. So he changes into a hawk and he tries to escape the skies. But the flames are so high that they kind of almost burn his wings. And until this day, the hawks native to that region in Polynesias have this red undersinge, which is why they have that look. Soon enough, Maui dives into the water as a fish, but the water begins to boil and Maui is not able to go anywhere, and suddenly the fire is engulfing. And in desperation, Maui decides to call his ancestor. He calls his ancestor, who's basically the god of wind, whose name is Taviri Mate. He's a very famous god in the in the stories. In fact, he's the he's one of the major gods, and he asks him to help him out. And because he's a god of wind and rain, suddenly a mass of cloud comes and starts pouring in, and all the fire that was there suddenly gets extinguished. So there is no more fire left almost. Mavika has lost so much of her power because of this, but she doesn't want to give up. Taking her last nail, she decides to take this fire and throw it at Maui just to hurt him. But Maui ducks, and this fire goes and hits a Kakyo Mako tree. Okay, that's a native tree that is in that region. And the trees are so blessed to have this thing that they engulf the fire, and they become completely dry. And Maui ultimately is left with no fire. And Mavika goes back to her cave and goes into a darkness completely. Now, Maui is not sure what to do. He doesn't have fire and he does not know what to do. But he keeps waiting and looking at the tree because he doesn't see fire in the tree. And after some time, he notices a couple of, Hawaiian mud hens. There are a type of water regional birds that they come. They pick up these fallen twigs of this Kakyo Mako tree, and he follows them. And he notices that they are having a bonfire. They have managed to create the thing, and he doesn't know. He's trying to wonder, wait, how did they manage to create the fire? So he decides to catch their leader and coerce them into asking or to tell them a secret. The leader first says that I'm never going to tell you the secret. You will have to kill me. But Maui, being a strong god, starts to really, really hurt him. At which point the leader finally, tells him that the way to do this is to take the sticks and rub them together to produce the fire. And he shows them. He kind of shows them that, using his beak, and he burns, he kind of shows them how to rub the thing. And because of that, his the mud hen's forehead gets burned. And that's the reason these mud hens are called Aloe Ula. That's the name of the birds in Hawaiian. And there's a reason why these birds have a red forehead and all. Okay, if you ever Google it, you can find that thing. And this is the reason why those birds have this thing, because that's how they used to create fire. And Maui finally learned from this. So Maui finally goes back to the village, and this time he's people are very worried because they don't see fire around him, right? He does not seem to have fire, but he shows them the trick he's learned from the birds. He shows them how to rub the two sticks, have a stick, rub it, how to blow on it, and eventually start the fire. And the villagers are very happy. They're now able to cook the food again. They're able to live in comfort and warmth. Maui has finally satisfied his curiosity of finding the fire, even though he cost everyone nearly that resource. And until this date, the two birds, the hawk and the mud hens, retain that look because of this adventure of Maui. And that is how Maui brought fire back into the world. So that was the story. I must say, I love the fact that Mavika used to wear the fire as these fingernails. Though I find it extremely funny that it took her 19 nails to suspect anything. I mean, for a god, she's definitely not really bright. No disrespect. But I think I want to ask you guys this. If you were Mavika, at what fingernail do you think you would have realized that Maui is tricking you? I think it'll be 6th or 7th, something like that. For me, I don't know. I would like to give any human being a benefit of doubt. So I think I will always consider this thing. Yeah, I see 6th, another thing. It's interesting, right? We have this random number. Actually, to be honest, I think I may still give all the toenails, but I would never give my fingernails. It just somehow seem more important to me. But yeah, do let me know what you think. If you have a particular magic number in mind, and let's see if we are smarter than Mavika out here. Though I must say, Maui was pretty convincing. I mean, obviously in the stories, I've not told you the dialogues that happened, but in his dialogues, he had this childlike quality of, being persuasive at the same time, being charismatic enough. Okay, I see the number decreasing. 4th one. Okay, I think that's interesting. I think the lower the number, the more mistrusting you are. Okay, that's an interesting thing. So yeah, that was the thing. By the way, just as an interesting fact, this is something I found out. I did not know this for a long time. The Polynesian word for the five fingers are actually the name of the five children that Mauika has. I can read out the names, though it's very hard to pronounce. The thumb is called Takunui. The four fingers are called Takorua. Middle finger is called Mapare, and ring finger is called Manawa, and little finger is called Toiti. Okay, so I like that fact that, you know, like someone is saying. So Rose says that she's going to whack Maui for his first request. You are forgetting that you are his grandmother in the situation, so it's going to be much harder for you to deny this thing. I think it's, you have to empathize with that situation. But yeah, I guess that's to each his own. The point is, finally, ultimately, Maui got what he want and Mauika lost everything. Okay, so that brings me to the third story. Are we ready to get into this? The third story is actually a very interesting story because it comes from a mythology which is not so well known everywhere. Unless you belong in that culture or you are in that region. This is a story of the story of grandmother spider's plan, okay, or heist. And so I'll just read the comments. Just interested, we have different names. Yeah, exactly. So what I meant was the names were actually coming from the name of the children. So it's almost like the five names are mythological characters. So that's the thing. So that's true. Wonder what a fire manicure would be like. I think it'll be dipping into a lava, right? So yeah, so getting back to the story of the grandmother spider's plan, already just hearing grandmother spider plan, you know where the story is going to be like, right? You kind of feel that the story is going to be very different in nature and in temperament and all. What's important to understand is that this story comes from the Cherokee mythology. Now, Cherokees are a tribe in America. They're sort of Native Americans. Just to show you the diagram, I had kind of made this. So, if this is United States of America, this is the region where the Cherokee tribes used to live. Okay. The documentation that we've got to know from them has been from the Spanish Inquisition in the 16th century and then 18th century, where some white scholars decided to write about them. So many of the stories, the oral traditions and all, have been something that has only been heard through a lens of people who have colonized them. It's only now there's been an active interest, and a lot of the Cherokee people are, in the modern language, they're telling the stories again. I had the privilege of listening to a few of them on my research and finding this out. Cherokee, basically, the region they belong is Virginia, Kentucky, Tennessee, Alabama, Georgia. This is that region they are in, okay? The Carolinas, the North and South Carolina, okay? What's scary to know is that, according to their number, Cherokee's numbers, they were almost, 800,000 people they had. But the common, the modern consensus, it's always reduced to 300,000 people. So because of the whole, the white people coming and taking away the lands and the oppression that happened, lot of their culture, the land, and just their basic sense of life had been lost. So many of the stories have been lost, and it's only just reviving now because, modern people are a little more sensible about these things and empathic. So yeah, that's the story of Cherokee. That's the introduction of the Cherokees. What's interesting is Cherokees are also a very matrilineal society. Matrilineal means unlike in patriarchy, where there's a patrilineal system where we kind of trace a lineage through the father, matrilineal systems are where you trace the systems through the mother. Okay, and we have cultures in India also that do that. In South India, that's very common. In many tribal societies, that's very common. So Cherokee women are expected to be a very strong members of this. And you see it also, the stories itself. This is a grandmother spider story, right? So the stories always have very strong female characters. Someone, who kind of saves the day. Okay. So going into the story, okay. Long ago, everything in the Cherokee world was complete dark. in the beginning there was no light. It was all cold until the thunders, okay, the Anihun Tewala, that's what they were called. They lived in like this Easter Island situation. They lived in a certain island that was in the east, and they had like this sort of a fireball stuck on a tree that was glowing, and many of the animals kind of could see it. They could make out the smoke coming from it, and they were very curious. Some of them would try to go on top of a like a mountain and all, and they could just see it in slightly, and they were very curious to get it. They kept, you know, the biggest problem with no light was that the animals used to keep bumping into each other, they used to keep hurting each other, and they knew that this is not the way they could live anymore. The animals decided, you know, there needs to be something done. And because of that, they held up a meeting, a council, where they decided to do what could be done. So the woodpecker says that I've heard that people on the other side, the island on the east, have this fireball, this thing. Maybe we should just go and ask them for it. Now the cunning fox chimes in. Ask them. We only need some of it. Besides, if we ask them, we'll have to give them something. Let's just steal it. The grandmother spider, a tiny creature, realized what the fox was up to. So she's like, why don't you show us, oh, you great clever fox, tell us how we can steal it. And she goaded him and everyone agreed to this. Now the fox, a little apprehensive at first, reluctantly decided to leave. It was his idea after all. So he swims over to the island, sneaks past the thunder guards, and he comes in front of this fireball and he's completely mesmerized. There's this amazing sense of sensation he's seeing. He's able to see some things clearly. He's almost drawn to this. Not knowing how to take some of it, he decides to take his snout, his nose, and he sticks it inside to grab a little bit, and then he heads back. When he's heading back and he's swimming in the water, he feels something strange happening on his nostrils. He smells somewhere in it, and there's some weird smell that is there, and it's suddenly becoming very painful. And soon enough, he's not able to bear it. And just then, he just puts his face inside the water. When he comes out, he feels he's lost the fire that was in there. And he comes back and he tells the council about the failure. And when the council people, they feel his thing, they try to feel his thing, they notice his nose is completely burnt out. He has a black snout now, which is how foxes got a black snout. Finally, a raven steps up. A white raven. Okay, ravens were very white. Yeah, that's true. Foxes are, always depicted clever. I really feel bad for the things, but I think it comes from the way they look. So anyway, the raven steps up and the raven is white in color. And it says that, you know what? Don't worry. I can fly there, grab some and come back very quickly. The council agrees. The raven begins his journey and he follows the light. And when it's following the light, you can see the light very closely. And not being noticed by the guards, it goes on top of the flame, the fireball, and it decides to consider what path to take. And after a lot of consideration, it decides to swoop in. But by the time it was deciding, all its white wings become black in color. And as soon as it tries to put its talons inside the fire, the heat is so excruciating that the talons get like, you know, weird bumps on his thing, and it goes into water and dunks it inside. And that is why ravens have always become black after that, and their talons are something that are not exactly very pretty. Empty-handed, it comes back and the council is still more worried. Finally, seeing the situation, a snake, she decides to slither forward. You know, perhaps I can get it on my back, she says. By being so close to the ground, I don't have to worry about dropping it. And saying this, it goes onto the island, slipping past the guards, who'd never bother to look down. Some guards they are. She is able to go in front of the fireball, and using its hide, its back, it goes and touches the fire and, you know, gets some of the fire on its thing. Now, when it's coming slithering and coming back to the council, it feels a strange sensation too. So strong is this weird sensation that it just starts rolling around, and it finally, finally rolls around on the ground. and when it comes back, there's no fire, but it has this weird scale-like structure on its back. And from that day, the snakes had a scale leathery structure on their back while having a very smooth underbelly. This is the reason why there is this differentiation between the two. Now, the council is wondering what to do. They're still very scared. They're like, okay, who can really help us? So the possum, you know, possum is a creature. You know, it says that, you know, if they're going to be so stingy about their light and this thing, you know what? Don't worry. I'm just going to steal it. I have a very big bushy tail. So don't worry. I'll put some and I'll get it back. Okay. And they agree about that. So finally, the possum decides to go. And you know, it sees the world getting lighter and lighter. It's able to go very close, and it is so mesmerized that it almost puts his eyes inside, and that's you know, suddenly, like, you know, he's almost blinded, and his entire eyebrows and all become black. And then finally puts his tail inside, gets a fire, and comes back, sort of a thing. When it's trying to come back, it smells something. Something is off, and then he looks behind. His tail was on fire, and just out of fear, like, you know, it just jumps and goes, you know, jumps into the water and tries to feel its tail. Oh my god, instead of the bush and hair, it has this worm like tail which is completely furless. Embarrassed, it comes back to the council, and disheartened, does not know what to do. Now the council is just devastated. Like, what are we going to do? We need some light. We can't function like this. So the grandmother spider suddenly crawls by to the thing and says that, I think you big creatures have done what you could do. Maybe it's time for a smaller creature to do something. Now, all the fox, the raven, the snake, and the possums, they all say that, you know, grandma, you're going to get burnt up. They're still nursing their wounds, and they don't think they have respect for the grandmother, but let's face it, she's old and tiny. Like, you know, what is she going to do? So the grandmother spider just contemplatively says, maybe not. I think there is a way we can, like, you know, manage about this. The council is so desperate that they finally let her go. So what the grandmother spider does is that she goes around, and in the mud she finds these damp clay. She kind of rolls this clay into a bowl, and then she comes to the council, says that, I'm going to travel with this. By the time I come back, it'll probably dry up. And then she takes her thread, the web, and she makes a path so that she could trace and how she could come back. Okay, and she goes over the water, goes over the land, and goes to the islands in the east. And finally, like, you know, getting past the guards, who literally have no idea what has happened so far, probably because they don't suspect anything. They're almost like the stormtroopers of Star Wars, according to me. Little Star Wars joke out there. But she finally goes inside and takes the bowl. Now, bowl, you know, in front of the fire, hardens up and almost becomes like a brick. She takes the fire, puts it in the bowl, and covers it up with her web so that the light is not going everywhere, and traces her way back using the web that she had. Now, when she finally comes back to the council, the animals can't hardly believe their eyes. They can't believe that the smallest of their animals, the most oldest of them, was able to manage to do that. When they finally open up, there's so much light that everyone could see. The fox, the raven, the snake, and the possums are now able to see the extent of their burn. They now know what are they going to look like forever. But the question began, you know, like, what, you know, where are we going to put this fire? What are we going to do this fireball and all? So the grandmother spider says that, you know what, this is something that has to be for everyone. Let's put it high up in the sky for everyone to see it and benefit from it. We'll call it the sun. Something, a sun that is for everyone. All the animals agree. They like the idea of a fireball as a sun being there on top. For anyone to see and this thing, but none of the animals are, like, they can go high enough. I mean, even the tallest of the tree will not be high enough for everyone to see. So they don't know who's going to be the one who can, like, you know, go. But then they finally decide that a bird is probably the best person to do this. And they know that this bird, a buzzard, okay? So a buzzard or this thing is a type of a bird that is found there. they're known to be flying very high, so they can probably go and do that. So they ask the buzzard, can you go, and he's chosen for it. The buzzard decides to place the sun on top of its head and starts flying up really high, taking grandmother's the bowl. But as he's flying, the fire gets really hot and it starts burning into his feathers and his feathers, and it keeps going higher and higher. Soon enough, the bowl starts breaking off and the feather is almost burnt off, and he's able to place it at some point, and the bird is comes back. But by the time it comes back, buzzards, the feather is completely gone and it's almost bald. And that's the reason buzzards have a bald patch on their head up until this date. So the sun is now burning, everyone's happy, everyone can see everyone, and they're all enjoying, and they all start singing. But suddenly, they're like, okay, we still had a little bit of fire that we stored out, right? Who's going to keep, who's going to take care of this fire? Because sun is great, but we also need fire on a daily basis. None of the animals are ready to touch it. They're literally like, okay, I don't want to deal with this fire because this has caused a lot of problems and all. The insects, like the grandmother spider, accepts the idea, the responsibility, but she's too small to actually manage that. So the question becomes, who's going to do it? And suddenly a voice comes, we'll do it. No one had thought this creature is going to speak. There's this couple of creatures known as humans who were not powerful, who did not have any ability. They stepped forward and they had not spoken at all in the things because they had nothing to contribute until then. So they come by and they say, let us take care of that. You animals have done us a great deal. You've sustained a lot of sacrifices to ensure that this is something that is meant for everyone. Let us do that. All the animals are relieved and they're excited, and they give the fire to humans who are taught the different ways that they can do. The grandmother spider, because she's honored, she teaches the humans how to make pottery. That's why Cherokees were very, pottery was a very important, tradition in them. And there's a reason why, because of the sun rays, the rays of the sun that come out, inspired by that, the grandmother spider's web also looks like the sun rays. So basically that was how the inspiration came in. And because of this, the world finally got a sun and humans got fire. So hope you like the story. And this is something that comes out in a very, very beautiful way. I love the explanations of how the animals kind of have their reasons for doing so. Kind of the thing, we need to be very grateful about that. Okay? I mean, all these animals, the fox, the raven, snake, possum, buzzard, all suffer because humans were something who needed to get fire. So yeah, that was the story. And that covers the three stories. I do want to mention one thing, is that these stories tell us a very different ways of how fire came to the earth, to human beings. I hope you guys are enjoying this this thing. I must mention that, when I started this off, I was trying to also find an Indian story. So I told you in the starting that I'll tell you, this theft of fire is not limited to only three stories. It's across different mythologies. In fact, in different traditions and different tribes, the stories change. In some tribes, a rabbit steals it from an old lady, and there are these different reasons that come out. And so is there a reason that, or there is a story or a mention of a story in our Vedas. In the Rig Vedas, there's a story of Matar Risvan. Matar Risvan, the word itself means someone that grows from a mother. Okay, Matar Risvan, okay, someone that grows. Now, the problem is that it's not very clear what Matar Risvan is. In some interpretation, he's probably the name of Agni himself. In another variation, it's a name of a bird, a mythical bird, almost like the phoenix. What is known about the things, or what is mentioned in the passing line, is that he's considered a messenger of Agni who brings the fire to Bhrigu. And it's mentioned that he brings the hidden fire to Bhrigu, which is the reason why a lot of people have interpreted this as similar to him being Prometheus. In fact, a few things are known about him. In one of the stories or one of the mentions, it's mentioned that as soon as he was born, he devoured his parents. And the reason, you know, like he's called the Matarishwan is because when Yagna is, you know, when Yagna is taken, the Yagna, or this thing, the arrangement is like a mother that, you know, ultimately nurtures the fire. And that's what Matarishwan is. So there's a lot of inconsistency and incoherence and all. And I was not sure of how do you draw parallels, but I just thought it's an interesting thing to mention. I haven't found any clear story. So I think what would happen is that, you know, you'll have to take creative liberties of making your own stories and creation about that thing. But it is interesting that even our mythologies have dealt with the idea of stealing fire. It goes to show that, you know, fire was something that was a highly sought out commodity. It was a resource. And I want to bring out something very important about the theme that comes out, right? So if you think about fire, right, it's a resource. It's a resource that had been come out. And if you see the three stories, right, let's look at all the three stories. In the story of Prometheus, it is something because of a rebellion, because Prometheus rebels and he makes a sacrifice, fire is attained. While in the story of Maui Strick, he requests and then he finds a solution. Even though his request, he keeps, you know, he throws it away and then he finally coerces an animal to get it. It still starts off with a request and he finds a solution of how to get it. While in the story of the grandmother spider's heist, it's a story of reliance. They rely on animals and then finally by sharing is how all the animals get it. So this tells you something about resources itself. There are different ways we have a relationship. Okay. I want to point out a very important thing. The idea of whether it's a sacrifice, a solution, or, you know, it's something that is shared. The way you deal with a resource, the way you deal with it kind of tells you about the way you think about power and how we manage a situation. Our current situation, we are having a lot of, a lot of scarcity of resources and all, right? And we have this tendency of, you know, wanting to hold it. I mean, remember when COVID started, our first instinct was to do panic buy. And that's the thing, right? We were almost resorting to this idea of stealing from people who really, really need it. And I think fire is a reminder in us through our stories that we have this in us to resort to our nature, which can always want us to steal it, but also create a sense of insecurity when we are stealing it. So what's interesting in different stories is that the way, the reason with which it's stolen can also change. And what you do with fire is also as important as why you got it. Also, I want to say that fire itself, right? I mean, there are two metaphors. We've been talking fire in a very literal way, right? But if you think about fire itself, fire is something that you can take in a very, very objective, external way, which is fire as a literal thing. Basically, then it stands. Fire stands for technology. Everything, electricity and all, has come because of fire. And that's, you know, when you look at an objective thing, fire represents innovation. But you can also look at fire from an internal thing, you know, fire in terms of creativity, in terms of something that you want. And that means inspiration. So this tug of war between innovation and inspiration is what fire represents. And the idea of stealing, right, doesn't have to be seen in a negative light. Stealing can also mean looking at this thing. I mean, if you think about inspiration, if you steal inspiration from someone, I mean, you know, the whole idea of a good artist make and the great artist steal comes from this idea that, you know, we can always learn from someone else. If there's anything that's common in the stories, it's the idea that, you know, this is a time where cultures were interacting with others. You know, this is a time when cultures were able to figure out something. And in some ways, the stories are a way of crediting the fact that, you know, we interacted with someone and we got it out. Okay. Yes, stealing obviously comes with this idea of, you know, doing it in a very deceitful way. But I mean, if you take it in a more metaphorical way, sometimes stealing can be a good thing because it can lead to the betterment of human civilization. So yeah, that was the stories, and I hope you guys enjoyed it. Do you have any questions or anything? Please put it in the chat. I'll be happy to answer it. In the meanwhile, I'll just tell you, I was wondering about like fire as a concept, you know, like what does fire mean to me? Anyone who knows me knows I'm not a person who likes hot stuff, okay? Like when it comes to food, when it comes to anything, I mean, I'm not a person who likes hot climate and all. I like things. So fire is something that is not something I really, have the personal thing for it, but it fascinates me. Oh, wait, I have a question. So is it safe to say the Cherokee story fire is given to on animals fashion makeover? Yeah, I think that is true. I think it's a complete fashion makeover. In fact, I'm pretty sure if PETA was there, they will say it wasn't just a fashion makeover, it was a cosmetic torture. And I think the fact that, you know, finally all the animals had to suffer so that humans could get it is sort of like, you know, the parallelism that, you know, we test on animals to see what, you know, what humans can do. Yeah. Any other questions or any observation or anything else you guys have? Do let me know if there's anything you would like to add or, you know, ask and all. I'll be happy to. Is there any particular story you liked the most amongst the three? Anyone the thing? I mean, which one was your favorite story amongst the three stories? I personally like Maui's story a lot because it just seems so silly. But the Cherokee story obviously has this childlike quality. I mean, the more I was thinking about it, the more I was feeling like, you know, oh my God, what happened to this animal? And it was very exciting thing. Yeah, I see the grandmother one. I think, you know, most of us will obviously like that one. It's the one that has a more happy ending in some ways than like Prometheus one and all. I see the grandmother one is winning. But yeah, I mean, this is also interesting. I mean, I must tell you this. I see someone likes the Maui one also. That's great. Okay, so dad likes Maui one. Okay. I was thinking a lot about this idea of relationship between fire and sun. In many of stories, fire is something that comes out of sun. I think in Indian mythology, you know, there are two different devtas they have this thing. So in fact, I had been working on my own stories, which had this backstory, mythological backstories. So I must share this. So in that, you know, what I was working on, the fire god Igan comes from, you know, Dias, the sun god. He's a son, you know, like his literal sire. And Dias does not trust Igan because Igan is getting very popular amongst human beings. So it sends the Selen, the moon, to spy on it. And this is a story that, you know, me and Rohina, we had worked on this. And obviously, this is a backstory for stories to come in. But what was interesting about the story was that, you know, when we were sharing it across to people and all, and a lot of people are asking which culture it's from. And it just told me something about mythology itself, that it's so easy to create stories and have fun with it. But I think what makes it mythology is someone believing in it. So if enough people believe in it and you give it enough time, maybe you create your own mythology. Yeah, so that's the thing. Let's wait for a couple of more minutes. If anyone has a question or anything to add. Rajiv Uncle, you're saying a lot is available on Sun God. Definitely. So the stories of sun and fire are a lot. I think what I was covering was the theft of fire. There are stories about, you know, yagnas getting, you know, like destroyed and all. But like, you know, they were a different theme altogether. They were about destruction and this thing. In terms of stealing and in terms of this thing, the stories came from Vedas. But yeah, I mean, that's the thing about mythologies. I mean, you know, a small twist in the narrative and you can make a new version of the same myth. So, yeah. Okay, so everyone, I think, I hope you guys enjoyed the session. This was a lot of fun for me to cover. I hope you found stories interesting, and I'll be back with more stories and more themes to cover. Just to let you know, like I like mythology a lot. I mean, you've been seeing the content of what I've been creating and all. But I also like, you know, trying to think about mythology in a current context and how the mythologies itself can mean new things for us. The idea is to make mythology fun, you know, and I think while mythologies have a lot to teach us, the main purpose of mythologies had always been something to engage with, you know, engage with the world. Okay, there's a reason why mythologies were always told to kids in a storytelling way, whether this thing. Obviously, when you layer it out and you know, go deeper into it, there is something to learn from. Like every story, you know, there are things you can do. So keep an open mind. try to engage with mythology in a way that is inclusive, that tells you there is no right or wrong way of interpreting it. There is a lot of context and information and wisdom in the ways mythology has been covered, and it's good to know that. But it's always good to, like, you know, look at mythology from an open mind and try to find out what the stories could mean to you. So this was about what fire meant to us and how we attained it. I hope to see you guys again soon. We'll be coming back with the next content. And yeah, you know, stay curious. Okay, cool. Bye, guys.